and wrote to them.
And there were lyrics that we could really relate to. And when he was singing about back in the USA and the hamburgers sizzling, etc., we'd only just about got hamburgers over here with Wimpy's, and you just realised that there was another whole attitude to a hamburger, and you could smell this sizzling, you know? It was just... He just painted these pictures. It was so lyrical, and you just knew as a teenager that there was something really going on over there.
New youth television shows like American Bandstand were also embracing the rock and roll phenomenon.
The importance of American Bandstand to Chess Records, or any record company at that time, was creating a hit record for you. It reached millions of homes that the small R&B stations did not reach.
Max Cooperstein was a good friend of Dick Clark, the host of American Bandstand. Max encouraged Dick to put Chuck Berry on his show.
Here he is, Mr. Chuck Berry. He got in Louisiana, close to New Orleans. Way back up in the woods among the evergreens.
American Bandstand was one of the most watched music shows on US television. Chess Records was now operating on a much bigger stage. The label was now crossing over into the white mainstream media, even teenage movies. The film Rock, Rock, Rock featured a number of Chess acts, including Chuck Berry and his latest hit, Roll Over Beethoven. This song perfectly captured the moment when rock and roll changed the world for good.
He's saying, you know, once it was classical music, you know, or once it was jazz, or once it was this, now it's this new thing called rock and roll, you know? And he was making that actually come true.
Roll over Beethoven, I gotta hear it again today.
Like the Chess blues artists before him, Chuck Berry would have a huge influence on the giants of 1960s rock music, especially the Rolling Stones.
The Rolling Stones are one of the inventors of rock music, the entire genre. And so when you pass on that influence through them, that goes through the entire history of rock music.
But in the middle of Chuck Berry's huge crossover success in the late 1950s, Chess Records almost shut down. In 1957, Leonard Chess had a heart attack.
He was frustrated that his career would be sidelined at this crucial moment of his life. And of course, he didn't stop really smoking, and he went right back to work. The whole family was horribly upset.
Just when Leonard, the label's driving force, should have been avoiding stress, there was another crisis for him to deal with. Chuck Berry, Chess's biggest-selling artist, was accused of taking a 14-year-old waitress across state lines.
It was devastating for us when Chuck Berry got arrested with a federal crime called the Mann Act.
You got to help me. I can't do it all by myself.
We did everything we could to keep him from going to prison, but we failed. He went to prison.
I can't do it all by
But the
myself.
Controversies for Chess Records didn't stop there. At the end of the 1950s, the label was under investigation when the payola scandal swept the record business. Payola meant giving backhanders to radio DJs to make certain records a hit.
Some of these jocks got crazy, and they buying big cars, big fur coats. And the Internal Revenue wanted to know where the money was coming from.
The majority of our payola were disc jockeys who got a salary check every month. And we did deduct the taxes. We didn't break the law, because they were going after everyone on breaking tax laws, because payola wasn't illegal. They let Chess off the hook.
At the end of the 1950s, despite this series of setbacks for the label, Leonard was determined to be at the forefront of the new style of music emerging from the black underground.
Oh,
sometimes I get a good feeling, yeah. Yeah.
We really wanted to expand Chess. We were under the impression that the electric blues was dying out. The sales were dropping. They started buying soul music.
Some of the producers got smart and they start writing optimistic songs, you know, like I'm Gonna, and One Day Soon, and It's Gonna Happen. And they start writing things that you look forward to.
I don't want you to be no slave. I don't want you.
After the label's difficulties in the late 1950s, soul's fresh new optimism spread to Chess Records itself.
I just wanna make love.
The label's next star would break the Chess mold. Rather than another male musician from the South, their new star was a young 21-year-old woman with attitude from California.
Etta James was one of the prettiest black girls that I had ever seen. Plus, she could sing.
And oh yeah, and oh yeah, and oh, and oh, and oh yeah now.
I think it was probably Something's Got a Hold on Me, the first thing that I heard. It was just a vocal that was just summed it all up. Everything was good, all this sort of blues and gospel.
She was top notch. Number one, just put it like that. Whenever she came in, everybody started moving.
In the recording studio, Leonard provoked Etta James every bit as much as his male blues musicians. And despite rumors, their relationship was purely platonic. Even so, it was still highly charged.
Leonard Chess never went with Etta James. There was never a relationship there other than musically and him trying to keep her straight. But he had a relationship with Etta where he could curse in the studio. And it would burn up Etta to the point to where she just really, really would start singing.
He had her crying, and he ripped her contract up, and anything to get the emotion out of her when she sang.
At last, my love has come along.
Out of this volatile relationship came some beautiful music. Leonard knew Etta was special and was more than willing to splash out on large orchestras when recording lush ballads, like the 1941 wartime classic, At Last.
That song came from Etta's deep down in her, an inner place that nobody else could reach, nobody else can reach, because it didn't come from her voice, it came from her soul.
My heart was wrapped up in clover. The night I looked at you.
Her maturity and her, you know, the scope of her talent was such that it didn't make any difference how old she was. She felt it and she made you feel it.
A dream that I can call my own. I found a thrill to press my.
One thing that made Etta so prized at Chess was her musical diversity. At Last, both the album and the single, were big hits for Chess and helped change the label's public profile.
We were getting recognized by radio stations that we hadn't been getting airplay on with any of our artists. So it did open up a lot more avenues for us.
For you are mine at last.
In 1963, with Etta at the height of her powers, Leonard was still restless. With his eye on the future, he took another business gamble, spending $1 million buying a local Chicago radio station, which he renamed WVON, the voice of the Negro.
WVON, giant sound of soul.
We were the first big station that went 24 hours of personalities and playing R&B and blues. Huge, big, unbelievable.
You just had to lock into WVON. It was part of your everyday occurrence in terms of just dealing with life, period.
I mean, the thing that made WVON so special is that it took community issues and made them omnipresent, and then giving organizations time that they would never, ever have.
By the summer of 1963, rather than serving a variety of Chicago's minority communities, Radio WVON now catered exclusively to the city's huge black population.
Somewhere dying, we need love. More love. That's what we need. That's what we need. We need more love. More love. That's what we need. That's what we need. We need love.
Leonard and Phil understood that they found their first success in the black community. And while it may be a cliche to say, we want to give back something, he did, but at the same time thought that there was nothing wrong with having a successful business enterprise.
WVON, the voice of the Negro. I'm Herb Kent, getting ready to jam like a big dog.
As the chess empire in Chicago was growing, the fight for black American civil rights was heating up. Leonard was shocked at the images of racial violence coming out of the southern states.
When he saw the dogs and the hosing of Selma and the civil rights marches, he was really upset. He knew about the segregation. We were called nigger lovers many times by many white people across America.
In 1963, Marshall, now 21 years old, experienced this racism firsthand whilst recording the live album Bo Diddley's Beach Party in South Carolina.
I want everybody to keep up some noise. I want you to holler, I'm all right.
When Bo Diddley's black maracas player Jerome Green jumped into the white audience, all hell broke loose.
All of a sudden, the lights start flashing, in walked police with German Shepherd police dogs. Sound shuts off, concert's up, over. What's going on? Everyone is confused. Cops took me on the side, they threw me against the wall, said, Jew man, you think these niggers can dance here with white people? You got another thing coming. If you don't stop this, we're gonna lock you up and your people won't know where to find you for 2 weeks. We stopped the concert. Ended up having to go sit in my hotel room and listen to a honeymoon couple through the wall in the next room.
Well, let's hear that number now that's shooting up the charts, called Little Red Rooster.
I am the little red rooster, too lazy to crow for day.
The following year, in 1964, the Rolling Stones, who Marshall Chess would later manage, became the latest sensation after the Beatles. Their early releases included numerous Chess covers, including a version of Howling Wolf's Little Red Rooster.
Keep everything in the farm, y'all. Upset in every way.
They first became the Rolling Stones, they were a band, they were playing not quite the whole Chess repertoire, but, you know, maybe 90% of what they was doing.
The dogs begin to bark, hounds begin to howl.
Out of all the British invasion bands of the mid-1960s, it was the Rolling Stones who really turned white America onto the blues that Chess had released a decade earlier.
It's kind of blinding to the point where, you know, bunch of guys from the UK got to introduce blues to America, because America, both black, which, you know, in the black radio and media circles says, oh, that's older people's music, nobody trying to hear that no more. And white circles just being totally oblivious to black music.